Praise the Lord. Good morning, temples of the living God.
Good morning, temples of the living God.
Good morning.
Temples of the living God. Good morning.
Good morning.
Yes, ma'am.
There was more violence, more energy, more
Oh, and they're not talking about a holy, righteous God. They're not talking about a God who died for me. They're not talking about a God who gave me breath. They're not talking about a God who gave me food. They're not talking about a God who healed my body. They're not talking about any of those things, but there was more energy and life. God said, I'm not interested in format, but no fellowship. Lukewarm praise and worship instead of heartfelt worship. The thing about the JC match last night is them people were in it. In it. And guess what? Me and Alvin in the tour. I in the show, watching the show, you know. And I'm wondering, oh gosh, when I came in, it was 2-1. I wonder what the thing is now. Guess what I did at halftime? Get on the phone, call my son. How much going? Match finished, what's the score? Yeah, let it go back to Father, no, no, no. Come in, intimate, when you're passionate about it, when you want to do it, when you've got a want-to, and God says, I'm tired of people who don't have a want-to for me. I'm tired! You don't have a want-to for me! You have a want-to for oh, God. He says, I don't want indifferent serving. I want a wholehearted surrender. He said, I'm tired of lip service instead of loving submission. He said, I'm tired of murmuring and complaining instead of thanksgiving. I'm tired of living by sight instead of living by faith. And he said, I'm tired of programs without power. Actually, the programs without power, you just tell me while I was sitting there. I am tired of programs without power. And just in case you're making it up, go home and read Amos chapter 5, where he told the children of Israel, take away from me the noise of your sorrows. I don't want your worship. I will not smell in your sorrows. You're exactly right. I don't want it. Because if I'm God and you're not prepared to give me your best, keep what you have. I don't want what left. Oh, Lord. Oh, Lord. The evidence is glaring. That was one experience. The other one I had, went to visit a man, a friend of my husband's. Man has no hands from here. No hands. 13 years with no hands. He went into the church this Sunday, committed his life to Christ and joined the church. And Tuesday, no hands. Accident happened, no hands. And so we thought, okay, let's go visit him. We went and sat there, figuring it'd take 10 minutes, 20 minutes. 2 hours later, I am sitting riveted in the presence of a man with no hands. Because for 2 hours, he talked about the goodness of God. And love of God. The joy of the Lord just poured out to this man. That there was oh God, you felt like you were in the presence. And I left there thinking, when anybody sits with me, do they hear that? For 1 minute, do they hear that? For 10 minutes, do they hear about the presence of God, the power of God, the joy of God, the ministry of God, the gifts of God? Do they hear that? No hands for 13 years. That man would put a lot of us to shame. And I got to thinking, God, maybe we got too much. Maybe that's the problem. I've learned that the more that you have, the more you have to worry about. Years ago in Barbados, we had one car. Then my husband bought a second car. So we go to church, and because we drop people to church now, we have 2 cars. We're sitting in church, rain came down. Guess what? I have to go now and make sure 2 cars lock up instead of one. We are too much. We are concerned about too much. And it's sucking the life of God out of us. That man sat there and he said, you know, man, there are some things that happen, but guess what? I have no interest. It is about God. And then he lost his wife 2 years ago, which you would think, make him sit on there and say, oh God, are you giving me a free man? And you take me away? Oh God. I
I so enjoyed two riveting hours. We could have stayed there except that we had to go to the bad old auntie. And he said, you know, if I'd only stay here this whole weekend and tell you. That man understood God. That man knew what it meant to love this God and serve this God. And so in 20 minutes, Father, in the name of Jesus, we repent first, we repent. God, we repent this morning. We come in here half-hearted, half-weary, half-sick, half-done, half-interested, perhaps just to please somebody, just to see. Let me go to church because the thing we do every Sunday morning, like the sister said, we put on our clothes and we come. We have no anticipation of meeting with you when we come in here. We have no anticipation of anything changing. We can come in here, we can get up a Sunday morning pep talk, and we will go home and read our papers and do what we like for the rest of the day and the week, and then come back next Sunday morning for another pep talk, and we will convince ourselves that we just serve the living God. And so we repent. For passion, lack of passion, for lack of zeal, for lack of interest, for lack of love for you. God, people pursue world more than we pursue God. No wonder they don't want to join us. When they look at what they're doing, they see some semblance of life in their pursuit of death. They see so much death in our so-called pursuit of life. Shake us up this morning, God. Every one of us, individually, together, shake up this church, shake up the program, shake up the church. Just God, we need a change. All morning we've been singing about change. We're talking about stepping from old to new. Oh God, show up and do something in this space. For your sake, God, and for ours. Don't make me go home the same way we came, God. Don't make me go home the same way we came. Oh, God. It's the spirit of the living God. You already start talking. Because you're the one who will convict us, you know. You don't leave us the way we are. But I pray that nobody in this house feels condemned, because condemnation is never from you. You turn on the light and you show us what needs fixing, because you want to fix it. And your desire this morning is for all of us to look into our hearts as you deal with this word and to say, oh God, fix it! Instead of run and cower and hide under the condemnation of the enemy, seeking to be destroyed because of our guilt and shame. God has nothing to do with condemnation. He has everything to do with conviction. Turning on the light and saying, come my children, make me fix it. Make me change it. Make me give you the new thing that you want. And so bless this word to our hearts this morning, and let your name be glorified. In Jesus' name. Amen. Praise God. You still here?
Yes.
God, not responsible for anything said hereafter. Once I got to stand here, because I've given the Holy Spirit complete and total permission. So if you have anything, any issue with what was said, please talk to the Holy Spirit. God had 7 lessons from David. And we're talking about sacrifice and stewardship. 20 minutes on that one. We're talking about sacrifice and stewardship. And the first thing I want to say is, look here, living a life of sacrifice or a good stewardship is both an attitude and an action. So many times we focus on the action. God said it's attitude first. What's attitude? Attitude is a way of thinking or feeling about someone or something, especially as it influences our behavior. Read it again. Attitude is a way of thinking or feeling about something or someone, especially as it influences your behavior. So we need to ask ourselves, what's my attitude to God? What's my attitude to the kingdom of God? How do I feel about this God? How do I feel about the kingdom of God? What do I really think about God? unless there is first a teaching.
And you know when you get up Sunday morning in service, but you got to do all them other things.
What's the attitude?
It's a
huh? And the people come in and they say, let's worship the Lord. So she could try it every time. That's an attitude.
Oh Lord.
Who is God to you? Is he the all-powerful, all-knowing creator of the universe? Who you better serve or you feel the consequences? Is he God on demand?
Hey, these days you got everything on demand. You can even get your JPS on demand. Pay as you go. Huh?
And so we put God in there. God, you're God on demand. If you, God, are going my way, I am coming. If you're not going my way, you could take the highway, God. I ain't coming. God on demand.
Or is your God the one who made us in his image and likeness? Because he wanted to be so close to us. He wanted relationship and fellowship with us. He wanted us to be more like him. Not occasionally, but daily, daily, daily. Not Sunday morning worship service, daily. Which is why you had Jesus stick in the prayer. Give us this day our daily bread, because it was daily prayer. And have Jesus said to us, anybody coming after me, let him come, take up his cross daily. The Luke version says, and follow me. Because you see, the way you view God will determine your willingness to sacrifice and to offer stewardship to God. If your attitude to God is right, your actions will be right. So if the action's not right, it's because the attitude.
To make a sacrifice and to do stewardship is always a matter of choice. It's choice. And it's the same choice, folks, that you used to come here this morning. You choose to get up. You choose to bathe.
Well, most of us, I think, chose to do that.
We choose to comb our hair. We choose to put on clothes, because there's no naked person here. We choose to put on shoes. We choose to put on chains and earrings. We you know how many choices you make to come in this place? You choose to come through the gate. You choose to park your car. You choose to come in. And you didn't choose to lie down in the middle of the floor there. You choose to sit in a pew. It is the same choice box that you need to use to choose to do work. So when we're not doing what he said, it's not that we can't choose, it's that we won't choose. I will not choose to come to church early, and I will not choose to come to prayer meeting, and I will not choose to worship, and I will not choose to witness, and I will not choose to tell the truth. I will not. It's not that you can't, it's that you won't. And that's what God said to his church in these end times. You will not. It's not that you cannot. Because I'll give you everything you need to pull. It's that you want.
Sometimes we give gifts to people. But we give them what we like. So I like red. I don't care if you like blue. I give me a red dress. Take it. I like electronics. I don't care if you like farming. I give you cell phone and electronic equipment. Take it.
We don't always consider the person who has to receive the gift. But God is saying to us that real, genuine, sincere giving, stewardship, and sacrifice always considers the other person. What would a person like? What would really please them? What would excite them? What would contribute to their well-being? And so David in Psalm 160, David looks at his life and David says, oh God, when I think of all the benefits that you pour out on me, God, when I think that you hear my prayer and answer, you incline your ear to me. It's as if God, you're there, but you've got such care and attention and concern for me that once I start talking, you start leaning your big ears to hear what a little person like me said. When I think of how gracious you are, God, when I think of your mercy and your grace, when I think that you don't pay me for the punishment that I deserve, when I think that you preserve me and you help me, when I think of how bountiful you deal with me,
bad news tonight. In the last few weeks, we lost 3 14-year-olds at least. 3 14-year-olds. One, the man stabbed him up on the bus. The other one drowned in the YWCA pool, or YMCA, whichever one, pool. The other one, stone rolled down from the hill in St. Mary and killed him. And I asked myself, oh, my 14-year-old's gone. I still remember. We lost at least 3 18-year-olds. One drops down 2 minutes into the football match. One on his way home from the basketball match. The other one in the plane that crashed. And there was a 19-year-old in there too. And I asked myself, why is it that 19 and 18-year-olds gone and I am still here? When I consider all his benefits, what did I give him? And that was David's challenge. David said, listen to me, I was in deep trouble. I was in deep trouble. He talks about the time when he was in great distress. He talks about the difficult time. He talks about bodily pain, trouble of the mind, heartbreak, worry, fear, anxiety. David says, like death I've been facing, man. Sorrows, death, pain, hell, trouble come past me around. I was brought low. Oh God, that's where I've been. And look where I'm running. What am I going to give to you? And you know, what can I offer unto God, he says, for all his benefits towards me? And I read some of the definitions of sacrifice. And some of them go something like this. Sacrifice is to give something to God in order to win his favor. Give up something to God so you could get his favor. That sounds like bribery to me. Can I tell you the church is involved in bribery? Oh God, if I pray more, if I fast more, if I give me it. Let me tell you what real sacrifice is. The giving up of a valued thing for the sake of another that is more important and more worthy. That's sacrifice. That's stewardship. The giving up of something you value for the sake of the other who is more important and more worthy. That sounds to me like Christian sacrifice and stewardship. Who is more important and more worthy than God himself? If I can't even give up to him, who is more important and more worthy? Then what are you doing in life? And so David says seven things. Seven things. Because David points out in that text that really, the only thing that this God would enjoy, the only thing that would please this God, the only thing that delights this God. You see, we like to give God a little money. And some of us fuss to give him the little money. Oh God, the church only my money. Can I remind you, Psalm 50 says, if I were hungry, I would not tell you, for the world is mine, and the fullness thereof. Can I tell you all the money in your pocket belongs to God? That house you're living in belongs to God. The car you're driving belongs to God. Can I tell you all the things that you're holding back on him is his own anyway? Oh Lord, sister, all I want is money. I don't give a tent. And I give him a tent stitch. Look here, we need a new attitude. We need to, it all belongs to you. Aren't you pay JPS? Come on, don't answer. Pay JPS like Bill, come on, right? And you pay NWA water, come on, right? Aren't you pay? Because I guarantee you that that breath that you got in your body breathing with right now, more expensive than any water bill and any light bill that you insist on paying. But when it comes to God, if you had to pay for your breath, some of us dead a long time.
test your heart.
Hey, is his own. He allowed you to give up that car to you can test in your heart.
Well, sister, no dirty people are going to come in my car.
Oh, well, that's your car.
I remember years ago, I was in Belize. And Lord gave a word that September, Isaiah 61, the Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, for He's anointed me to bind up the brokenhearted and all the things that go in the word, you know. And so when we get holy now,
Yes, Lord, the Spirit of the Lord God, and bind up beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning.
And so one morning I drove my son to school in my nice little white Honda, well polished, well clean car. Drop him to school. I parked over by the hospital in Belize because it's across the way from the school. And then I'm getting back into the car. And there is this woman, dirty as ever, wrapped only in a hospital gown with a nasty, dirty man over her cussing and so on. And I slipped into my car and the Holy Spirit said,
"You think that is one of the broken hearted that need binding up?"
Excuse me, Holy Spirit.
Is there another Holy Spirit? But you can know about it.
I have a choice. I could send my car nice and clean and beside that woman dirty and I don't even know where she's coming from, and beside Lord, I don't even know where she's going. And in any case, you should drive in the car and dirty the car and I don't even know if she's doing it. I have a choice. Okay, Holy Spirit. So I went to the man, I rebuked him for cussing out the woman. I said, "Where are you going?" And he put this woman naked as the day that she was born, except that she's wrapped up in a hospital white gown into the car and took them where they were going. Because that's stewardship. Yeah, man. Because you see, the only thing that God really enjoys and will accept wholeheartedly above every material, physical thing on earth is the one thing that He limited Himself to not having total power over, and that's you. How do we know that? Well, He says, "If any man will hear my voice and open up, I will come in." Man got to hear, man got to open up before I come in. I am not kicked down the door by the God where I come in and crash into your life and taking it over. You got to choose to give to me what I gave to you. God says you. Because all that power, boat and pain and soul don't belong to me. I own the cattle on a thousand hills. The only thing I give permission to say whether it belongs to me or not is the human being.
And why did He do that? Because He made you in His image, man. You got mind to think like He thinks. You got heart to feel like He feels. You got will to choose like He chooses. You got spirit like He has spirit and packaged it in a body. But you lost His likeness. When Adam sinned, He lost the likeness. He lost the Holy Spirit of God. Lost the likeness. So God said to give you a chance to get back the likeness. Yes, ma'am. So is you. What shall I render unto God for all His benefits towards me? What can I give Him? And what about the ones who have seen a back turn to the table? He said those are the ones who commit their lives to me. But there is no fellowship. Them just commit and come sit up on the chair and them turn their back. Them back on me. Tell them to turn around. Let's have fellowship. That's stewardship. That's sacrificial living. Not just to be born again, but to have continuous fellowship.
That Revelation text, you know, that we like to preach to unbelievers, was not written to unbelievers in Revelation chapter 3. You know, when I stand at the door and knock, was written to the church. What Jesus doing outside, knocking outside the church, he could be done, get saved. We look like we pop up.
I saved you to become like me. That's sacrifice. That's church. And that third thing that it says, our obedience. I will walk before you in the land of the living. I'm going to walk before you, God. You are going to set the parameters, the boundaries, the extent for my walk. If there is anywhere you don't want me to go, may not go, God. I'm going to walk in obedience. Continuous sacrifice means continuous surrender and continuous awareness of the presence of God. I will obey you, God. And Jesus himself shows that. Jesus said, the words I speak are not my words. I only say what my Father said. The works I do are not my works. I only do what I see my Father doing. Where is the church that is speaking what the Father speaks? Where is the church that is doing the works the Father did? In Matthew chapter 9, he says to them, listen to me, the harvest is plenteous, but the laborers are few. He wept over Jerusalem. Matthew, he said, pray to the Lord of the harvest that he might send forth laborers. Matthew chapter 10, and it wasn't chapterized before. Just a few verses though, he calls them and he says, listen to me, I am sending you. You go heal the sick. You go raise the dead. You go deliver the people from demon bondage. You go cast out demons. Where is the church that's doing that? Where is the church that is manifesting the power and the presence of God? Every Sunday we meet, where is the church? Well, last to see somebody walk into any church you've been into, but get healed. That you could say, I was healed, ready. In July this year, we had an amazing experience. This lady comes, she brings her son for counseling. She brought him to Thursday. She's in a lot of pain. Her body's twisted like that. According to her, she was in her bathroom one day in May, and something happened, and since then the body twisted up and she had a lot of pain. So she came back the next Thursday and brought back the son. He comes to the son and said, we're going to pray for the son. We prayed for the son. And then I heard my mom looking at the lady. The lady's not a Christian. She's not a Christian. She wasn't there. I looked at her and said, lady, let me pray for you. And so we're praying, oh God, touch this lady. And I had my hand in the nape of her back. And she said, oh, the back, the hurt. So I moved my hand now, and I am not the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit don't even need me to touch you. And I'm folding my hand. The two sisters are there. We pray, oh God, just touch her. In the name of Jesus. Body be commanded straight up. The lady drops on the ground. And we hear the lady shouting, oh God, my body to move, my body to move. Oh God, my body to move, my body to move. And the lady gets up straight as hell. The taxi man who waited for a shot. Now you can tell him God don't save, man. Evidence! God said I need to see evidence in the house.
Granted, the rest of us shall do that.
Oh God, we pray such unbelieving prayers. Thank you that you have passed that. Lady jumped up, man, and walked out to their street, and she is not a Christian. Our obedience. 14, David talk about is our submission and service. David says, God, I am your servant. In Psalm 116, 16, 18, and 19. I'm your servant. If I'm your servant, it means you're my master. If you're my master, it means my job is to do what you say. So when you tell me, God, lay hands on the sick and they shall be healed. And I am in your space, not laying hands on the sick. Then I'm not your servant. And you know some of us? We are servants of the church. We're not servants of the true and living God. So the church said, don't you dare lay hands on anybody in here. But God said, lay hands on us. Which one are you going to do? I would do the one that makes me most comfortable. I'm not going to lay hands on anybody just in case nothing happens. I missed the presence and the power of God. Submission and service. What am I submitting and what am I using to serve? The Bible says, present your bodies. This is the temple. See yourself as the temple of the living God. This is a place of prayer and praise and purpose and worship. This place here, not this building here.
need to know Jesus. And on the road and you see somebody in need of help and you're waiting to get into the building to say it. Sister, that's why the sex take heavy over. Because the temples of God not declaring the works of God. Satan got his agents out there declaring it 24/7. What do you expect? We claim to be the children of the Most High.
Your body is the temple. And I think that the last time I check, everybody got a face. And on your face are your eyes. What are your eyes seeing? Huh? I represent vision. What's your vision? The Bible says where there's no vision, the people perish. When you look at people, why do you see everything? Do you even bother to look at people? Do you see lost humanity needing to be restored to the presence of God? Or do you see the people like the people, the Christians? Thank God for the brothers on the school class. Brothers on the school class? Be blind. So we can tell the pastor he can carry home the man or whatever, but we don't plan to carry home because we have no vision. We can't see beyond the person's issues that they need a connection with God. See, the problem is we get too good. Among things that God has taught me is the good is the enemy of the godly. We so good, we not godly. The good, I'm a good person. Hey.
There is none.
Paul said, the chiefest of sinners. But we have taken on that image of Christianity that says, we're the good people. It's them people out there.
Say your face. What you doing with your eyes? What you doing with your ears? What you listening to? Some of us in the last, you know, US elections, last little while, eh? Some Christians spend more time listening to Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton than they spend reading the word. Trust me on that.
We have to sit down for all them debates. We don't sit down for 90 minutes to hear what God has said. But we got to hear what Trump said. And emails flying between Christians. And the word is lost.
Where are you with your eyes? Where are you with your ears? Where are you with your mouth? What are you talking about? What are you doing with your heart? What you do with your mind, what you're thinking about, what choices are you making?
All those things are part of your sacrifice and stewardship.
And then Paul says the 15-hour fellowship, I will call upon him as long as I live.
God, fellowship means talking with his people. That's what God, that's what fellowship means for God. And that's why after he made Adam, he made sure every day, morning or evening or whichever cool, whichever time was the cool of the day, he came looking. He came for fellowship. Adam, you need to ask me how to take care of all the common goat and sheep, because Adam, you were not in existence when I made them. Eve, you need to ask me how to take care of Adam, because you were not there when I made him. Adam, you need to ask me how to look after Eve, because you were sleeping when I made her. That's what God intended. Fellowship. Constant dependence on this God. But we are too independent.
We don't need God for anything. Why must God? We got all the solutions. And so we jump up. More security. Oh, the crime rate. Bring more police. Bring more this. Bring more that.
God, listen to me. Crime is a matter of the heart.
A 16-year-old gunman from one of them inner city communities in Kingston tell us that. We were doing counseling, and one of our counselors went out and came back. She was going to refer him. And he said, miss, I know what you're trying to do, you know, but miss, badness is not of the mind, it's of the heart.
Changes hearts!
Yeah. Minister of National Security? Yeah. Commissioner of Police? The government?
Who changes hearts? And if the heart changers are not in the place to promote heart changing,
that was supposed to happen. I don't understand us as Christians. We're not behaving like Christians, but we expect everybody out there to behave like Christians.
Your body.
Paul says, your fellowship, talking with God. Prayer is the key. And the reason why you're so powerless, church, check the prayer meetings. It's the least, it's the least attended service in any church. Any church that got a vibrant, active prayer meeting is a vibrant, active, powerful God that sees the miracles of God. Any church that got it. Because those people know how to plug into the power of God and then manifest it. They know it's not their power. They plug into the power and they manifest. How do they plug in? In prayer. They can say, I will call upon you. I will call upon you. Oh God, my hands will say, I will call upon you. And then the sixth thing David says is praise and thanksgiving. Allow for to be the sacrifice of praise. Yes, ma'am. Hebrews said that too. Let him offer the sacrifice of praise. Thessalonians said everything give thanks. Because you see, praise God. God gets excited about praise. Talking about giving God a gift. One of the best gifts God loves is when his people praise him. Woo! When they praise him. And praise has nothing to do with situation or circumstance. Praise has to do with who God is and who you believe God is. So we can praise him in the prison. If you know who he is and if you believe who he is. And you can praise him in the pain. And you can praise him in the pit. And you can praise him in plenty. And you can praise him in poverty. Because praise has nothing to do with situation and circumstance. Praise has to do with who he is. So when I see my brother without his two hands, praising God, hey, from here on, the man has nothing above here. And the man praising God. I thought it's a lift holy hands, but if you don't have them, guess what you do? You lift holy stubs. Because it's not about you and who you can. But sister, I'm too tired to praise. But sister, I'm too hungry to praise. But believe me, stay hungry. Because the Bible says he lives in the praises of his people. David says, hey, I'll praise. When I start praising God, it's like if God come down in there and carry up with him till I forget what it is he was. Because I'm so caught up in who my God is. If Christians would start praising God, things would change. I don't know about you, but when you start praising God, the atmosphere changes. When you get down in some good mood, you're just praise for God. And you dance to the Lord. You come in and we sit in these pews and oh God, hey, oh God. Woo!
Praise God! Come on, you gotta praise God. Hands, you gotta praise God. Fingers, you gotta praise. Listen to me, ears, you gotta praise God. Eyes, you gotta praise. Because guess what? You can't be you without my God. So whether you like it or not, we're gonna praise God. Body, we're gonna praise God.
Yeah. That's how you live it. That's how we just live. Not in mournful. You know when you tell people that you get saved and you're miserable and you want to come to know God? And people say, I'm so happy out in the world. Why must I come in the church and be miserable? And guess who gave them that perception? We did. Oh God. I sit in churches sometimes and tell you the truth. I want to laugh out loud. I just want to scream and laugh because I see so many faces. Oh, God, oh, oh. No, no. Rewind, let's say it fast. Oh, God, it is past, and that's where you shall stay. Because I'm living in the past. Someone's living there. Oh God, my open edge is past. That's where you shall stay. spiritual living is demonstrated as a life of witness to God, a life that manifests the presence of God. But you cannot be a witness for God if you do not serve people, because you cannot love God whom you have not seen and hate people whom you will see. The reason God can't hate people is because God can't hate his own image. Master told me that one day I was praying, how come you can love the world, God? How come you can love this world? He said, because I can't hate my own image. And then he said to me, and you, if you belong to me, you can't hate my image either. So if you're going to serve me, you got to love people. You got to be a witness to people. David said, I'm not waiting until my funeral. I'm going to serve God in the land of the living. I'm not waiting till they put my casket or my urn there. No, man. I'm going to serve God in the land of the living. My stewardship is going to be in the land of the living with everybody around. My stewardship is going to be with the people of God. My stewardship is going to be in the church, in the courts of praise. My stewardship is going to be my community in all Jerusalem. David was not going to let anything or anyone stop him from living for God. And David was only prepared to give God the best, because he knew that that is what God wanted, that's what God desired, that's what God would rejoice in, that's what will bring God greatest pleasure. David was not going to give God the red dress when he knew God loved the blue, or give him the electronics when he knew God loved the farm equipment. David knew that more than anything else, what God wanted was a surrendered, submitted human being who he could empower and use for his glory and his splendor. That's what God wants. God wants some people that he could display his splendor through. And so David, in another text, in 2 Samuel, David sums it up. David says, I will not offer unto God a sacrifice that costs me nothing. I will not offer unto God that which costs me nothing. I will not offer unto God. David had a chance in that 2 Samuel 24 text, you know, and verse 24. David had a chance to offer God a free threshing floor with some free animals, because he was going to make a sacrifice. And Aruna said to him, you can take the threshing floor free and take the animals for the sacrifice free. You don't have to pay me for it. David said, no man, I'm going to pay for it, because I will not offer to God anything. Cost me nothing. How about us this morning? Are we offering to God sacrifices that are costing us nothing? Are we giving God the what left? Do we even desire to give him the best? Because you see, until you desire, there will be no doing. If you don't desire to give God the best of your time, and the best of your treasure, and the best of your talk, and the best of your talents, there will be no doing. So it has to go back to attitude. It has to go back to desire. What are you prepared to sacrifice for all this benefit? Every pew is an altar. Not doing altar call because I suspect. Rather, you're only doing altar call for those who are not believers yet. If anybody wants to commit their lives to Christ, this altar is there. God has given you all that you have. You're sitting in this church this morning and you're not a Christian. You just heard of a God who wants the best for you and who wants to use you for His glory. But apart from that, for every Christian in this church this morning, the pew you're sitting on is your altar. What are you giving to God? We're going to reflect on that a little bit, and then we're going to sing, "I Give My Life Away." One of the things I encourage people to do is don't sing songs just because it's in the book. Because you have to give an account to God for every word that you speak. So if you're going to sing "I Give Myself Away," I have no desire or intention of doing that, no matter sing. And people say, "But sister, how you could say that? How you could say that?" Listen to me, God is not mocked. The saint, He'll expect you to honor what you sing. And so, Father, in the name of Jesus, we talked about sacrifice and stewardship today. And your servant David took us through seven things, God. Seven things that manifest our sacrifice and our stewardship. Our love for you, Lord, as we're sitting here, how much do we really love you and your kingdom? Our relationship that leads to continuous fellowship. How much of our lives really are intended to continue in fellowship with God? Our obedience, God. How much do we really desire to obey you? Our praise and thanksgiving. How much do we really praise and give you thanks in our daily living? Our submission and our service. How submitted are we to you, God? And how passionate are we about serving you? Yes, God. And our witness. Our witness with our words. Our witness with our walk. Our witness with our lips and our witness with our lives. Father, there are so many of us as Christians who don't witness to anybody. We can't tell the last day we tell anybody about how to get saved. We can't tell the last day we told anybody that they needed Jesus. We can't tell the last day we walked up to somebody, recognized that your spirit was saying we need to speak with them and spoke with them or prayed with them. Oh God. 14 years old have left earth. 18 years old have left earth and you still have us here. I pray, God, that we will understand today that the reason we are here is for a purpose that is bigger than our own self and our own self-interest. And by your Holy Spirit, may you stretch us, God. We repent this morning. We ask you to forgive us. And we pray that even as we sing this song, it will begin a new stage and a new phase of our Christian walk. Life, sacrifice, and stewardship in Jesus' name. Let's stand. We're going to sing this morning, "I Give My Life Away." I want you to meditate on what you're saying.